Divine Truth Interviews. Jesus, Mary and others are interviewed by members of the media and the public. Mary interviews Jesus on the subject of partner relationships. Recorded on the 20th of October 2015 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia. This is Session 3, Part 2.
What does love look like in the relationship?
Well, again, this is a very important question. In fact, probably the most important question when it comes to the relationship itself. Perhaps what we need to do before we discuss what it looks like is to emphasize the importance of love existing inside of the relationship. And from God's perspective, no marriage actually exists unless love exists in the relationship. Love felt and received, given and received by both parties in the relationship. So in other words, from God's perspective, you're divorced, even if you're married, if you do not love your partner. Mm-hmm. So marriage, from God's perspective, is the love-based relationship between the two of you, right? Okay. And that requires both of you being in a state of giving and receiving love. And it's love from God's perspective, not some kind of codependent addiction bartering system, which God defines as love. That's not love at all. And from God's perspective, any marriage that is a codependent bartering system is also not marriage. They're divorced.
Yeah.
They shouldn't be together from God's perspective.
Yeah.
From God's perspective, the only relationships that will survive are relationships that perfect themselves in love. And any other relationship, partner relationship we're talking about here, marriage or partner relationship, any other partner relationship that is not based on love will eventually, through God's laws, be destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
And God purposefully designed God's system like that, so that any unloving relationships will eventually be destroyed in the future of your life.
Mm-hmm.
So if we look at it from that perspective, we can see that from God's perspective, the imperative is that you either bring your relationship into harmony with love, or from God's perspective, your relationship will be destroyed, does not exist right now, but in the future will be destroyed by God's very own laws.
Mm-hmm. The illusion of it will be destroyed.
Of course, yeah. The illusion of the relationship will be destroyed by God's laws, because all of God's laws are going to bring you into harmony with love. And at some point, by being brought into harmony with love, you'll recognize that your relationship is out of harmony with love, and you'll need to either change it or disband it.
Mm-hmm.
You will need to destroy it. So we need to understand this. Like, it's a very important thing to understand. So from God's perspective, a relationship breaking up is not necessarily a bad thing. And from God's perspective, a relationship staying together is not necessarily a good thing,
mm-hmm.
either.
Mm-hmm.
It depends upon the underlying motivations of the both parties involved in the relationship. If both parties have love for one another, then there is a binding force. And from God's perspective, that is a marriage.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as that love does not exist, from God's perspective, there is no binding force. And from God's perspective, that is a divorce.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what we do with paperwork on earth, that is the truth about everything from God's perspective.
And what do you feel about, say, we've been talking in this series a lot about a lot of us coming to terms with the fact that what we call love with our partner is not really love.
Mm-hmm.
What about the aspiration of both parties to love? Is that a binding force?
Well, the aspiration of love is different to actual love being
yes.
existing. But of course, the aspiration of love is a powerful force in itself. So two parties could recognize that actually their relationship is based around codependent addiction, and then develop within themselves, recognizing at that point that from God's perspective, they're divorced.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter what they think about it. And then at that point, recognize that they need to change that, and they want and they both desire to change it. In other words, they both have the aspiration to change it,
mm-hmm.
and to become more loving with each other. And therefore, there is the beginnings of a relationship from God's perspective.
Yeah.
And as they develop the aspect of love, so rather than being in codependent addiction anymore, they're actually developing this loving relationship from God's definition of it. Then, of course, they're now entering a union from God's perspective that has the basis for a positive union that is of love, right? Yeah. So from God's perspective, that would be fine.
Yeah.
The problem is when people don't enter a union of any kind, including a sexual one, with any desire for love to be present.
Yeah.
From God's perspective, that is immoral and unethical.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore wrong, and there will be soul-based consequences, penalties that the laws demand, God's laws of love, in fact, demand upon the person if they engage those kind of relationships. So when you engage relationship after relationship after relationship in codependent addiction and facade, only to have it break up when you realize the truth, you have actually committed many sins from God's perspective with regard to sins about love. And as a result of those particular sins, you will have a degrading soul condition,
mm-hmm.
something that will need to be addressed either at your passing or beyond or beforehand, depending on when you choose to address it. So having a codependent addiction in relationship that's primarily based around a codependent addiction that I'm married to the person,
mm-hmm.
from God's perspective is a sin,
mm.
right? And this is very different viewpoint to what humankind and people religiously have of marriage.
Yeah.
If you maintain facade and codependent addiction and do not have truth in the relationship and frequently lie in the relationship and do not have humility in your relationship and you are frequently unloving to each other in the relationship, you have sinned many, many times from God's perspective.
Yep.
And staying together and sinning is just as bad as being apart and sinning.
Yep.
So we need to get our perspective right. From yes. God's perspective, the paperwork does not matter.
No.
What matters is the heartfelt attitude on the part of each party involved in the relationship.
Yeah.
And are those people focused on developing this relationship in harmony with God's love, truth, and in harmony with their own humility?
Mm-hmm.
If they are, then there is a binding force, mm. a marriage, if you could call it that from God's perspective, between the two parties.
Yeah.
But if that does not exist, no marriage exists from God's perspective.
It really puts it into perspective, doesn't it, that love is the basis of any partner relationship,
mm-hmm.
and without it, it doesn't exist. And if it's maintained through
without
using
it.
Other things, yeah, codependence and or domination. And
or just hoping
submission.
To be around for the children.
Yes. A sense of martyrdom or perseverance or long-sufferingness or whatever, that actually that's the perpetration of a sin that has law of compensation effects.
Upon the human soul.
Yeah.
Both parties in the relationship, in
yeah.
fact.
Yeah.
Yes. And it's very important to understand that if you remain in such relationships without addressing the problem,
mm-hmm.
that's different than remaining yes. in the relationship while addressing the problem,
yeah.
which are two very different states.
When in fact God views them completely differently, doesn't he?
Yes.
One, staying without even wanting to address, just wanting to stay in denial, not wanting to address any of the issues.
Is basically a purposeful sin on God's from God's
perspective.
Analysis.
Whereas someone who's in the relationship and decides, look, whoa, we got problems. We just watched series one, session one, two, and three of partner relationships. There's some work to do. I want to do that work and I want to take responsibility for my issues.
Yes.
From God's perspective, now we're entering the zone of actually repairing damage.
Correct.
And moving away from compensatory effects for our
and moving
issues.
Away from sin.
Yeah.
We're moving towards the aspect of living in harmony or perfecting our love.
Which is cool, isn't it?
Which is exactly what God would like us to do. And in
yeah.
fact, it's exactly what all of God's laws were designed to bring us to do.
Yeah.
All of God's laws are redemptive and educational in nature. And they are all about trying to educate us about how to become a loving partner in a partner-based relationship and educate us that love is the binding force of the relationship. Without love, there is no binding force. And every person who passes into the spirit world without love finds that all of the so-called relationships they've had up to that point, including any person they were married to, is they're not even interested in, generally,
mm-hmm.
because love wasn't the binding force in those particular relationships. And I'm suggesting to people on earth, why waste your time with relationships where no love forms the basis of the relationship? Either make love the basis of the relationship or leave the relationship and have a relationship where you can have love in the relationship. Mm-hmm. You need to do something like that.
Yeah.
Rather than just sitting in the relationship for the rest of your life on earth, committing the sin of inaction, not deciding to live out of harmony with God's laws of love while you're in the relationship. You cannot stay in a relationship that's unloving and remain in harmony with God's laws.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, you cannot remain in a relationship out of harmony with love or truth and humility and hope to not sin, because you will be sinning.
Yeah.
You will not be perfecting your love. Therefore, you are imperfect. You are missing the mark when it comes to God's love, and therefore you are sinning.
Mm-hmm.
And there are compensatory effects for staying in relationships that are unloving, as well as beginning relationships that are unloving, as well as leaving relationships that are loving.
Yeah.
So, you know, we need to make sure that we understand that love is the governing law from God's perspective, not a legal contract.
Mm.
A legal contract is humanity's desire to try to patch up all of the emotional injuries so that they can force some kind of harmony between couples, so that society is more cohesive, so they are easier to govern. And God does not do all of those things.
Yeah, throw in a few legalities and a bit of shaming for...
Correct.
And control a
lot of emotional manipulation, a lot of people, get them all to do what you want, which is the primary motivation of most, you know, governments or religions with regard to morals and ethics. So rather than being truly moral or truly ethical, they will say, a woman might be married to an abusive man, but she can't get a divorce. Now, from God's perspective, they are already divorced.
Yeah.
There's no such thing as a marriage in the first place, because the man's not being loving to the woman, no matter how much she loves him. There's no marriage from God's perspective under those circumstances.
Yeah.
The marriage is only capable of developing if he loves her.
Mm-hmm.
Remember, love has to be on both parties for the marriage to exist.
I can anticipate a lot of questions about your last statement.
Yes.
You saying that if I love you,
mm-hmm.
but you do not love me,
mm-hmm.
I am not married to you?
Correct, even if we're in a relationship.
So what is the status
from God's perspective?
From God's perspective, my soul loves
also,
you.
Also, if you loved yourself, you wouldn't be in that relationship.
Uh-huh. That's where my error in love is.
Correct. You're breaking one of God's primary principles of love, which is love of self.
Yeah.
And you would not remain in a relationship with a person where you love them, but they do not love you.
So
I've made that mistake in my past.
Yes.
And I understand the compensatory effects that come about when you love somebody and that they don't love you. Because there's quite a significant number where you feel sad and you feel depressed and you feel lonely, and there's all sorts of feelings that come up as a result of not being loved, right? Some of them addictive, some of them not, come up as a result of not being loved, and that's because you haven't learnt to love yourself, which is one of God's primary commandments of love.
So in that same scenario, if I love you, you don't love me and don't want a relationship with me,
mm-hmm.
and I work on perfecting my issues around self-love,
mm-hmm.
I might remove myself from the relationship but still love you.
Correct.
Would I be married to you in that case?
No.
No. Because marriage involves two parties loving each other.
Correct.
I could be faithful or have fidelity towards you.
Correct.
But I would not be married to you.
Well, in your heart, you are married to me,
mm-hmm.
under those circumstances.
Yeah.
But in my heart, I'm not married to you.
Yeah.
And therefore, no relationship, no marriage,
yes.
which is a joining of two parties. Exists mm-hmm. yet. Now, it'll be yet. And this is how most soulmate relationships begin, where one party has certain feelings and emotions for the other, but the other does not reciprocate them. And then over time and development of the qualities of humility, love and truth, the other party begins to feel the same feelings that the first party feels, the first half of the soul feels.
Yeah.
So, you know, and the reality is, from God's perspective, the real marriage is the soulmate relationship. So you mm-hmm. could say that the soulmates are married from the time they were conceived by God. However, they're not married in their own hearts until they both have a conscious recognition of the love that they can give and receive to the other half. So that's then a marriage of soulmates, if you like, from God's perspective. Until that point in time, God still sees them as joined, and in fact there is energetic connections between the two of them, but no love yet exists, or little love yet exists between them. And love is the binding force that causes the attraction. So that was a bit of a preamble to the love issue, which really, people can see is quite important.
It's very, very important. And in fact, you could call that entire preamble, what is the definition of marriage from God's perspective?
You could.
Because really that's what you've just discussed at length.
Yes. Yeah. Of course, there's a lot more you could say about the definition of marriage from God's perspective versus the definition of marriage from the earth perspective. Mm-hmm. But they are the basic principles that we've presented. And love is the binding force. So if you're going to have a relationship with a partner, you are married to them as long as both of you are in a love-based relationship with each other from God's perspective of love, not from your own.
Mm-hmm.
So if you believe you have such a nice relationship, but really from God's perspective you're in codependent addiction and facade with each other, then from God's perspective you're not married even though you think you are.
All right, so let's look at what love does look like in a relationship,
sure.
if love exists.
Yes.
So both of us know that each of us is injured in love, in fact, and until we're perfect, we'll be unable to be completely kind, compassionate, and understanding with each other on every matter.
Yes. So this is the aspect of love where we're making some allowances for each other's condition.
But not compromise.
But not compromises.
So let's talk about the difference between allowance and compromise.
Well, a compromise is that I allow you to have the difference in condition, you know, the aspect where you're being unkind in certain circumstances, but I don't say anything about it and I don't do anything about it and I don't act upon it and I just allow it to continue.
Mm-hmm.
That's a compromise. Mm-hmm. A person who allows a condition without compromise states, hey, babe, you've been unloving to me there. But they don't run off and find the next person to love just because that one compromise existed, and particularly when that person has a desire to address the particular aspect of unkindness that you've raised with them. So in other words, they realise that both are works in progress. And as a result, they both have a desire, both would need to have a desire to work towards love, mm-hmm. towards truth and towards humility in the relationship under these circumstances. And therefore, when one of them fails in love or is not perfect in love, or you could say sins with regard to love, the other makes allowances for that sin without actually compromising on the sin.
Yeah.
In other words, they don't allow the sin to get it be gotten away with, but it is addressed and raised in the relationship.
So basically you're saying you don't punish the other person.
No, because God doesn't punish either.
You don't like hold it over them and use it to guilt them into other issues. You're not manipulative.
Not manipulative. However, you may withdraw from a relationship under certain circumstances.
Sure.
So that's not a punishment, that's just an aspect of love.
Yep.
If you find that the person's cheated on you, for example, and you still love them, they obviously have to work through some issues themselves first to find out why they did such a thing. And if you stay with them, it's highly likely they will do it again unless they address those issues. And you might decide out of love for yourself and love of them to withdraw from the relationship. And when I say withdraw from the relationship, you may even live in the same house for a period of time with them. You just don't have the relationship, the sexual relationship with them. And you withdraw from the relationship waiting for them to address that particular problem.
Yeah.
And a person who truly loves the other will allow these kind of compromises even to the point of someone cheating on them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They will.
Yeah. So basically, when we love, we are humble and truthful about the issue. So we've already talked in the previous questions that we're going to raise the issue of love when we see it out of an honour for truth. We're going to be humble to our own emotions about what's occurred in our partner. Say the partner's had the
misfire or whatever.
Or just even...
Just a little thing.
I don't know.
They yelled at us.
Yes, something like that. We're either end of the spectrum, hey?
Yeah.
We'll feel our feelings about that.
Yes.
We'll be truthful about it.
We will. We won't just ignore it.
No, we won't.
So we won't compromise with regard to issue of truth.
No.
We won't compromise with regard to issues of humility, but we will make allowances with regard to the person being a work in progress.
So we'll actually be quite compassionate that the person, hey, you're a work in progress, there's this issue.
You're working through this issue. I'm not going to let you get away with the issue.
But I'm not going to expect you to be perfect before I love you or...
And I'm not going to expect you to work through it tomorrow, but you need to be working through it.
Diligent, yeah.
Right? Now, this is what I mean by an allowance. So it's a compromise of a kind, but when I say of a kind, it's really an allowance of the condition of the person, allowing for the fact that they desire growth.
Mm-hmm.
So if we look at the way God treats us, the way God treats us is that every sin that we engage has a penalty. No matter whether we whether God loves us or not, it's immaterial. Each sin we engage has a penalty. So inside of the relationship, each sin we engage from God's perspective has a penalty. Right? So you cheat or are immoral upon on your partner, there is a penalty associated with that sin. That will begin to occur inside of a relationship. One of those penalties is a lack of trust.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You're not going to be able to establish trust again without addressing the reason why you took the action that was the sin. The sin being, in this case, the cheating on the partner.
Mm-hmm.
You would need to address why you did it, emotionally address why you did it, for God to be satisfied. Not necessarily for your partner to be satisfied, but if your partner is near God, then your partner would also only be satisfied if you addressed the emotional injury that created your sin.
Mm.
Now, God allows you to go through that process and still loves you. And so your partner is capable of allowing you to go through that process and still loving you if they were perfected in love.
Mm. So this is where... our question is, what does love look like when we both love each other in this relationship? And our very first point is actually, well, if we really love each other, we're going to make allowances for the fact that
we're not
we don't love each other.
Correct. That we're not wholly perfect in love.
Yeah.
Now, eventually when we become one with God, we will be perfect in love. But before that time, we are not going to be perfect in love. We cannot expect of ourselves or each other. We can expect, however, the desire to grow to that condition.
So within this, and we're going to talk about this again in a later
state, question,
but we're not making excuses for the lack of love.
Correct.
And I feel this is a very important point.
Allowances and excuses are very, very different things.
We're not saying, oh, well, neither of us is perfect, so...
So I'll let you get away with that as long as you let me get away with a few other things, and I can even let me get away with that.
It's Friday. It's been a big week, whatever.
You yelled at me, you know, you had a bad day.
Yeah.
All these kind of things. We don't make allowances for these kind of things. We make allowances for the because the person has a desire to fix the problem.
Yeah.
If the person does not have a desire to fix the problem... then God does make no allowance.
Mm-hmm.
And so therefore we also should make no allowance.
Yeah. No, that's clear. That's clear. All right. So love in this relationship also entails that we both believe that if we're unloving, untruthful, or not humble with each other or ourselves, this is the greatest mistake we can make in the relationship.
Yes. So instead of saying like, oh, you forgot to pick up the milk as a big problem, we see any aspect of love, truth, or humility as a big problem and picking up the milk as a minor issue.
Yes, although we may address the issue if it...
Well, it may fit into the big problem.
Yes.
For example, if we're regularly ignored by our partner...
Mm-hmm.
And partly it's because we've asked him to pick up the milk and he doesn't take responsibility for his own milk, then of course we need to raise the issue. So problems are measured not by how small or large they appear to be by the human standards, but rather how small or large they are from a love perspective and from a truth perspective and from a humility perspective. That's how we measure the problem.
Yeah.
So a problem could be tiny from a human perspective, just that we forgot to pick up the milk, but it could be immense from a love perspective.
it could be a symptom of quite a huge issue of a lack of love.
Correct.
Or lack of honesty.
Correct. Or a lack of taking personal responsibility, loving oneself, or a lack of loving your partner, mm-hmm. or a lack of caring for what are your greed responsibilities, or and so forth. Mm-hmm. So they can be immense problems and yet be minor from the human perspective.
Yeah.
So we need to start seeing problems regarding love as and basically analysing their importance based around the concept that anything that is out of harmony with love, truth or humility is a huge issue. Mm-hmm. And anything that is not out of harmony with one of those three things and is just a little mistake or, you know, something that happened or, you know, or some minor issue, then that means hardly anything, if anything, at all in the relationship.
Yeah.
So now instead of getting all bitter and twisted because somebody didn't do something, and we would probably just say, did you have time to do it? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And they say, oh, no, I didn't, you know, whatever. I'll go and do that now or whatever. A lot of these so-called argumentative situations, a lot of the real argumentative situations that occur in relationships automatically disappear under these circumstances. Mm-hmm. Because both parties are analysing everything based on the principle of love, truth and humility, rather than analysing everything based on the principle of facade, addiction, bartering systems and other general ways that people do it on earth with regard to relationships today.
Yeah.
So it creates a huge difference in the relationship.
Yeah. Great. Okay. When there's love in the relationship, both I and my partner know we have injured ideas about what love is. And we've discussed this pretty much in the first point, haven't we? So,
well, but go on with the statement because it's important.
We've looked at in the first point that because we're injured in love, so we're already kind of acknowledging that we're injured in love, that we're not going to love each other perfectly yet.
So we make specific allowances.
Yeah.
Under the first point. Based on the person's desire to love.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
Now, this point is about saying, look, what we call love right now, we have to acknowledge that's probably not
love.
It's not a true definition because we know we've got issues. We're not loving perfectly.
Yes.
And there's disharmony in our relationship. We're not completely humble all of the time. So we're going to have to acknowledge that what we currently call love is not love from an absolute truth perspective.
Yes, so this point is basically saying that it's loving for us to acknowledge that our own condition of love and our own beliefs about love are seriously flawed.
Yeah.
And if we acknowledge this, then it means that some of the things that we expect from this relationship are probably, and in fact, the reality is if we expect anything from the relationship, we're all probably already out of harmony with love. And we'll begin to acknowledge that our expectations, which are based around our addictions and our belief systems and so forth, often are based upon flawed concepts that we've been taught growing up, but have no bearing on the reality of God's viewpoint of love. And if both of us acknowledge this, we will very carefully consider whenever we become demanding or expecting of the other party in the relationship. Because every time we have a demand or an expectation in the relationship, we are now not being loving. And it demonstrates to us that our viewpoint of love is flawed, seriously flawed.
Yeah.
And so this aspect of love allows us to see the serious flaws in our own concept of love compared to God's concept of love, or compared to pure love in terms of its concept, perfected love.
Mm-hmm.
And to realize that our own flawed concepts are not perfect and therefore will have to be given up if we wish to ever become loving individuals.
Yeah. Okay, next point. Mm. When we both love in this relationship, we have a desire to feel our emotional pain rather than dump it on the other.
Yes. Now, this is also related, remember, in the, I think it was point one that we raised in this session about humility. We had a section here about emotion, but this one is more about the loving aspect of feeling your own emotions rather than the humble aspect of feeling your own emotions. Yep. And the loving aspect is, if I feel my own emotions fully and I truly recognize what they actually are, I am actually being the most loving I can be to my environment, which includes to my partner. Mm-hmm. If I, however, deny my emotions, shut them down, suppress them, try to manipulate them, try to control them, or any other such thing, I am now being unloving to my environment and therefore also to my partner. Yeah. And also the same applies to my partner if they're doing the same things with me. And what this then demonstrates is that if we're ever going to have a relationship that's loving with our partner, we are going to have to experience emotion. Mm-hmm. And in fact, love itself is an emotion.
Yes.
So unless we feel the emotion of love, we don't really love. It's just an idea or a concept. It's what's called agape love, a love based on principle. It's not real love. Real love comes from your heart and is based upon heartfelt feelings and desires and passions, not just on a principle, right? So if we examine a relationship, the love needs to come from the heart. It's not, it's principled because all of God's love is principled, but it's a feeling that comes from the heart as well as a principle. And we need to understand that. We need to get that. We need to understand that unless we're feeling emotion, love is not possible to flow. It's not possible that love can flow between my soul and yours unless I'm feeling an emotion and you allow the feeling of my emotion. Yeah. And then you feel an emotion and you allow the feeling of yours.
Yeah.
And we need to see the importance of emotion in the relationship. This is particularly problematic for many men. Mm-hmm. They begin to judge emotion as a problem in the relationship rather than seeing it as an important aspect of a relationship.
Yeah. A lot of people who've lived very shut down emotionally, as soon as emotion starts to happen in themselves or in their partner in the relationship, they can feel very frightened and feel out of control when in fact they need to get used to this new sort of state of interacting and so that things can actually improve and love can actually grow.
Yes.
Yeah.
So it's such an important aspect, this aspect of emotion. It affects us with truth, it affects us with humility, and it affects us with love. Yeah. You can't be truthful unless you're truthfully expressing your emotions. You can't be humble unless you're truthfully expressing and feeling your experiencing your own emotions. And you can't be loving unless you do it either.
That's right. Because the truth is, as soon as we shut down an emotion, there's an immediate effect upon our environment, as
yes.
you mentioned earlier, and we will end up taking out our unhealed emotions on our partner.
Yes.
There's no way around it.
And it feels really bad in a relationship. It really does. Yep. If you're open to emotion and your partner is open to emotion and then one of you closes down, you notice it instantly and you know something is very wrong, right? It's a great way of measuring measuring the condition of the relationship moment by moment, feeling the emotions of the other party in the relationship. And my suggestion to people is they need to understand that feeling emotion is an aspect of love, and then love itself is an emotion. Mm. And therefore, emotion must be expressed and experienced and felt in order for love to bind the two halves of the soul together.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful system God made.
It is, yeah. Mm. Okay, if we both love, we both have faith that a truly loving relationship is possible.
Yes, this is faith in perfection.
Mm.
So I see this is a big problem with the world today. Very few people have faith that perfected relationship is possible and the perfected individual is possible. In other words, they have no faith that it's possible for myself to become perfect, and they have no faith that it's possible for myself and my partner to have a perfect relationship. They believe both things are not possible. But from God's perspective, both things are possible. Mm-hmm. And in fact, God created the possibility of both things by creating laws that bring the parties to that place. And so we need to see and have faith in the fact that both of these things are possible. And if we both are working towards it, we'll get to a point where we enjoy the process of working towards that because of the joys of the relationship and its improvements.
Yeah.
And the perfection will be abound in all aspects of our relationship: kindness, compassion, understanding, emotional sympathy, emotional feelings going back and forward, sexual sympathy, sexual intimacy, sexual desire, sexual passion. All of these things will become perfected if we allow and follow God's principles to perfect those particular things in our relationship. If that's not happening, it's because we are compromising.
Mm-hmm.
On issues of humility, love, or truth.
Yep.
That's why it's not happening.
Yep.
And we need to fix that.
Yep.
But we need to understand that and have faith and trust God that God made a perfect, the potential for a perfect, loving relationship.
Yeah.
Just as God made the potential for me to be perfect, God also made the potential for us to have a perfect relationship.
Mm-hmm. It's a tough one for a lot of people to feel emotionally, isn't it?
Yeah, because there's very little trust that that is true.
Yeah.
And in fact, most people have tolerated huge imperfections in themselves and in each other. And as a result, they often do not work in that, you know, they don't have a viewpoint that God created a perfect system. And in fact, there is a general religious belief by most religions that humans are flawed.
Yeah.
And therefore are unable to be perfected individually, and also that because of that, relationships are unable to be perfect.
Yeah.
And these are both very serious untruths that are perpetrated on the planet, all based around general personal experiences of people, but they are untrue, nevertheless.
A lot of people have that feeling based on the relationship they had with their parent, that they feel disillusioned about the capacity to be loved perfectly or to receive love from a person because they...
I think it's not only that, though. Yeah. There's hundreds of reasons sometimes why a person may have a lack of trust in God.
And faith in a perfect relationship as well?
Well, that's also a lack of trust in God.
Yeah.
Because if you don't believe God created the potential for perfect relationships, then obviously you don't trust that God is perfect.
Yeah.
And that's a lack of faith and trust in God.
Yeah.
So ironically, many religions say a perfect relationship is not possible, but they demonstrate by that comment their lack of faith in God and lack of trust in God's laws.
Mm.
So yeah, if you really trust God's laws and trust God, you will come to believe in a perfect relationship.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, let's keep moving because there's
sure
tons more to talk about. When we love in our relationship, both of us in the partnership desire true sexual intimacy.
Yes, I see this as a big issue where, you know, there's many sexual arguments, I suppose you could say, that occur in relationships.
Mm-hmm.
Where there's a differing level of what, you know, they call it a differing level of desires, you know, and so forth. The reality is that all of these arguments are based on what I would classify as the wrong things being measured. In other words, you know, when we analyze things logically, we're often not very logical because we are missing out looking at certain aspects that cause particular problems. And this is particularly the case with sexual intimacy in a relationship.
So you're saying science measures. In attempting to find causes, they actually end up measuring effects.
Correct.
And causing and analysing the effects without actually
understanding
causes and where the problem is stemming from.
Correct.
And then they normalize that series of flawed understandings based on the effects.
And then they say such and such is true.
Is true. Yeah.
And we also do the same thing in our relationships with sexual intimacy.
Yeah.
The way God designed sexual intimacy is that once we're in the union state with our soulmate, we will be constantly having sex. Now, that initially is a very difficult concept for most people on earth to understand, and particularly understand the bliss of that kind of concept. And therefore, the soul-based relationship is the soulmate relationship is actually a sexual relationship.
Mm-hmm.
So if sexual activity is not present in a relationship, then you're certainly not working towards soulmate relationship. In fact, if anything, you're opposing the formation of a soulmate relationship. So we need to understand that God, from God's perspective of love, sexual intimacy is an essential part. And in fact, God created it to be a binding part of the relationship that occurs between two halves of the soul. As a result of that, any imbalance in sexual intimacy, shall we call it, where one party has a stronger sexual desire than the other, or one party has what I would call an addictive sexual desire, or one party is driven by addiction in their sexual desire, all of these things need to be repaired if the relationship is ever going to become in harmony with love.
Yeah.
This also means that if somebody does not have any sexual desire at all in a relationship, that they are well out of harmony with God's viewpoint of the soulmate or the or a love-based relationship. And they would need to, need to understand that in a partner-based relationship. And they would need to come to understand that. So there's quite a lot there that needs to be looked at when you look at it.
Yeah. What I notice that we've said there is sexual intimacy. We're not talking about sexual contact, but sexual contact. I just want to delineate between people thinking, right, sex has to be a part of the relationship. That means we have to have sex and that'll fix it. And that's not really what sexual intimacy is about.
No, sexual emotion will flow from one half of the soul to the other half of the soul. Once you're not blocked to each other, sexual emotion will flow from one half of the soul through the other half of the soul and through the, and their desire will flow through your desire and so forth. And that will be 24/7.
Yeah.
In other words, you know you will be bound together sexually and you will not be able to engage any other sexual intimacy with any other person because of this binding force that continues in the soulmate relationship.
Not even as a thought or an
idea. You won't even think of it.
Yeah.
You won't think of it. You won't conceive of it. You won't long for it. You won't imagine it. Nothing. The only things you can conceive, long for, imagine are all to do with the other half of your soul.
Yeah.
Now, any time that that is not true, it is because of an emotional injury where love is not perfected and it needs to be addressed. Mm-hmm. And both parties need to work through the addressing of it. And what I'm suggesting is if you avoid the addressing of it, then you're not loving.
Yeah.
And you need to perfect yourself in love from God's perspective, which means that you need to stop avoiding it and start working through the issues.
Yeah. Yeah, and they can be very complex, and that's probably a whole other
discussions. I'm sure we're going to have a series of discussions about sexual intimacy, obviously, about human sexuality, and we also will have a whole series of questions that we'll answer about sexual intimacy in relationships in the future as well. But at this stage, it's important to understand that if we truly love each other, we will desire to work through these particular issues to get to the point where the sexual feelings flow constantly 24/7 through each of us and we'll be conscious of it. It doesn't mean that we'll be having sexual intercourse all the time, but from an emotional perspective, sexual intercourse will be occurring all the time.
Yeah, and fairly regularly that will likely result in physical.
Very regularly.
Because that's a desire-based, the feelings are already flowing.
Yes, the feelings are constantly there and there is no imposition
resistance
to them or resistance to them flowing. So why would you avoid it if you had the opportunity? So what happens then on the physical level is wherever the opportunity presents itself, you probably take it.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Yeah. And if the opportunity doesn't present itself, you probably won't take it. But you will still be conscious of the flow of sexual emotion through both of you, even though you might not be physically engaged sexually.
Yeah. Okay. Well, following from that... both of us in this love relationship will desire emotional intimacy.
Yes, and what I say to sexual intimacy applies really in a larger scale to all emotion.
Yeah.
So in other words, I would allow an emotion flow through me, which you can then feel, and you would allow yourself to feel it, and you will have your emotional response to that feeling or have emotions flow through you, which you will allow yourself to feel. And as a result, if I allow my emotions, I will feel them. And this particular cycle will occur constantly. And so what that means in the end is you will have an emotion and I will feel it.
Yeah.
and I will have an emotion and you will feel it. And we would hardly even have to communicate to each other in the end what we feel. So what happens is that the longer this goes on, the less you talk, because the communication occurs emotionally now rather than through your words. Yeah. And you have a complete understanding of the other person's feelings because you actually feel them. Now, this is true emotional intimacy. Mm-hmm. This is what the soul is capable of doing. And it's what many people on earth avoid for lots of different emotional reasons. But it is a part of being perfected in your relationship with regard to love. So that in itself is a huge area.
I know.
A huge area. We could spend weeks and months, maybe, and even possibly years talking about that particular area.
Yes.
But I think at this stage it's important to raise it as a concept so that people who are working into harmony in their relationship begin to start to understand the concepts of humility, truth and love as they pertain to their relationships.
And even just to begin to conceptualize what we're talking about, even if it's intellectually, because eventually it will, if a couple is going to grow in love together and eventually join, this thing will occur.
Yeah, it's wonderful. It is wonderful. It's like if you can imagine that every emotion that's passing through the other person, you're feeling. So you don't have to ask them, what are you thinking? What are you feeling? You already know what they're thinking and what they're feeling. You're both acting. So you act more and talk less a lot of times, although you talk about what you're acting upon generally.
Yeah.
And you're both in a lot more harmony because you can feel each other properly. Yeah. You can feel what each other feels. You can feel what each other's thinking. You establish now a telepathic relationship.
Yeah.
In other words, your thoughts coincide. Your thoughts trigger some thoughts in me. Your emotions trigger some thoughts in me, and vice versa. This happens all the time in our relationship now. And as we grow stronger and stronger, it occurs more and more.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what needs to occur in all relationships if they're ever going to be truly happy.
Yeah.
And the contentment of that place is quite remarkable, actually. So it's not something to be feared, as what most people do.
Most people fear it, and that's what doesn't occur all the time.
Correct.
But you mentioned about the talking, and it's interesting that a lot of couples don't talk very much at all.
No, hardly at all. I would say the average couple probably talks a half an hour a day at the most.
Of quality conversation about real issues, truthful issues, emotional issues.
Not about taking the kids to school and going off to work and all those things. I'm talking about real issues about growing in love between each other.
Yeah.
And the average couple probably only does 5 minutes of that a day.
Yeah, if that.
If that.
If that. But, you know, we were talking about how you, when you start to grow this desire for love and humility and truth, often you begin to talk a lot more.
Yes.
Because you
well, you're developing this.
Exactly. You're in the development phase.
Of course.
So there's this peaking of talking that has to happen.
But it's all about emotional connection.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, like, if we don't speak about personal matters like at least 6 hours a day, it's very unusual, very unusual day. We have to spend a lot of time talking to other people in that day.
Or now we're starting to create more together, and so we are.
But even then we spend all the time talking and relating with each other emotionally. And so, it's like if you're only spending sort of 10 or 15 minutes having a talk about emotional issues with each other, you're going to take many, many hundreds of years probably to work through relationship issues. My suggestion is that you spend a lot more time at it than you currently do. And if a person listened to our Jesus and Mary's dealing sessions that we had a few weeks ago, they'd realize that we prioritize our relationships. Firstly, relationship with God. Secondly, relationship with ourselves and each other. And that's where we spend all of our time. Most of our time goes there. And then what we've got left over goes in other places, of course. But that's the primary thing that needs to be developed.
Yeah, I was just going to say that you were talking about when this emotional intimacy occurs, there's hardly any talking that's necessary, but it is necessary to move through this period where you're fostering that sense.
Yeah, I'm not saying, I think it's important the listener doesn't interpret what I said wrongly, because misinterpretation of what I've said can lead to a lot of problems. What I'm saying is the emotional intimacy that's going between the two of you is the talking.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you'll be talking, but emotionally 24/7.
Yeah.
Instead of talking blah, 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 blah words out of your physical body 24/7, you'll be talking emotionally 24/7. And when I say 20, I mean including when you're asleep, you will be bound together. Even when you're asleep, you go into the sleep state, you'll be up in the spirit world somewhere, bound together the same, exactly the same way, feeling exactly the same things. And so we need to understand that the concept that the average person on earth has of talking or communicating in a relationship will change. Mm. The real communication that occurs in the relationship is this emotional communication that begins to occur, and the telepathic communication that begins to occur as a result of it, which is established, which becomes so established that eventually it becomes the only way that you need to communicate. And you may have words, but you don't need them because you're already feeling each other perfectly, and feeling the emotion is the communication.
Thanks for clarifying, because I felt there was room for,
misinterpretation. It's good. Yeah. Because I think the average person would say we're not talking at all, and but the reality is we're talking, you talk more. When you're in a soul union state, there is no verbal communication anymore, mm-hmm. in fact. And there is only this soul-based emotional communication that occurs between yourself, God, and between yourself and the other half of yourself.
Mm. Awesome. Okay, so love in the relationship, we've covered lots.
And we could have covered a lot more.
Well, we've got more. We've got more on this list. Yeah. We've got four.
We could cover like a long, we could go for months on this. But what we want to do here is introduce people to some basic topics of where they can work on love in their relationship.
Yeah. So we've talked about things kind of in the positive, and now we're going to talk about things that we're going to remove from the relationship when there's love.
Yes. Yes.
So we remove our own desire for power, control, or competition in the relationship.
Yes, we see this occurring very frequently in relationships where it's like the couple is in a power play with each other constantly. It's about who can have the ascendancy over the other in the situation. And sometimes there's a swapping of ascendancy depending on the situation.
Yeah.
And it's a very damaging thing to do to each other. It can really badly destroy relationships if you continue doing this. It's driven by some very deep, unhealed, unloving emotions that need to be addressed as rapidly as possible if you're going to, to cure it.
Yeah.
But it needs to be stopped immediately. Relationships that are based on love are not competitions, and they're not power plays. And in fact, I think the next statement is about a power vacuum. Is that right? Or
not yet.
A few statements left.
Yeah.
I'll say the power vacuum statement.
Yeah, do it, because
power vacuums should exist in a loving relationship. In other words, there is nobody taking power. And that is a good sign of a good relationship, where nobody takes power. It doesn't mean that nobody takes responsibility, which is a completely different thing.
Mm-hmm.
But it means nobody takes power over the other.
No one's trying to win. No one's trying to feel better. No one's trying to
control. No one's trying to manipulate.
Exactly.
These are all signs of a good relationship.
Okay, next one. We're going to remove our desire to manipulate using punishment or shame.
Yes, I see this occurring a lot too, where people do not understand that if you truly love someone, you don't attempt to manipulate somebody by shaming them or punishing them for their behavior. You know, you quite often hear from men, I'm in the doghouse for a week because they did something wrong one day, This is not the kind of behavior that is loving. Their wife putting them in the doghouse, is not a loving behavior on her part. And the same applies to his, of course. He goes off, avoiding her for a week, fishing or whatever.
Yeah.
That's not the kind of thing that would normally occur in a loving relationship. In fact, because you're best friends, you'd go off, if you were fishing, and I doubt whether you would be by this stage because you wouldn't be, wanting to eat meat or harm fish.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, if you were fishing, you would do it together because your harmonies and your desires and everything would probably be more and more in harmony as you go. The reality is that most couples don't work that way.
No. And I see a lot of insidious manipulation and shaming that goes on.
Yeah.
And in Australian culture, it's very prevalent to make fun of each other in public.
Put each other down.
Make fun of your idiosyncrasies, which is actually
highlight your idiosyncrasies in public and as a way of shaming the other person or controlling them or manipulating them.
Trying to punish them for other things that
you... That you didn't punish them for privately or that you couldn't get away with punishing them for privately and so forth.
Outlet for suppressed anger.
Yes.
There's a lot of very horrible things
emotions.
Happen.
Yes.
All in the guise of having a joke.
Yes. And it's not funny.
No. And it is a way of shaming. You know, a lot of, sexually, a man might shame his partner. Oh, you're so frigid. You never want to have sex. There's a lot of desire to shame the woman into compliance with the sexual encounter.
You see it a lot with women, with men too, with regard to having him do something for
us.
You never do anything for me.
Yeah.
You know, when he might have gone to work 5 days a week, but he's got to come home and the whole weekend he spends fixing up things around the house for her, you know, and she implies to him that that is necessary, otherwise she'll be unhappy with him, right? These are all methods of manipulation and control, very unloving behaviour, and you certainly wouldn't engage it if you loved.
Yeah.
You certainly will engage it if you're in a bartering system with addictions.
Yes.
And that's very unloving.
All right. In this loving relationship, both of us desire to get to the heart of matters rather than avoid real emotional truth using self-judgment or the judgment of our partner.
Yes. When we say the heart of matters, we want to get to their causes. What really causes them from God's perspective?
Yeah.
So from the perspective of absolute truth, what's causing this problem?
Yeah.
And both of us have a heartfelt desire to get to the heart of the matter. We both want to.
Yeah.
Instead of, you know, one of us going, oh, I just want to avoid that, or I want to avoid that, or get away from me, you know, I don't want to do that. Like, and we see that a lot when it comes to tricky issues, you know, and quite often sexuality and other issues are called tricky issues. And so what happens is the parties, you know, avoid getting to the heart of the matter.
Yeah.
And there's usually they avoid getting to the heart of matter when it comes to worth-based issues as well.
Mm-hmm.
So anytime their worth is triggered, you know, they'll blame it on something else. You didn't do this, you didn't know. If you were kind, you would have done this. Instead of seeing it as, oh, I just feel a lack of worth here, or I feel he's not valuing my worth here, and seeing it as worth-based issues that we then, you know, want to shame or blame or judge the other person for their actions.
Yeah, and it's quite common to judge their partner for these issues, but there is also this other thing that happens where we let ourselves off the hook for our unloving behaviour through self-judgment and say, oh, it's just because I'm a bad person, I'm a terrible woman, and it's all a way to actually avoid getting to the heart of the issues.
Correct.
Which usually involves facing a fear, and so or some kind of emotion that we fear.
Yes.
And so we resort to punishing ourselves. Some people punish themselves.
Punish or judging or
food, with other habits, through just negative statements to ourselves.
Yeah, or even statements to ourselves that help us avoid what the real emotional problem is. We are frequently very slimy and slippery when it comes to finding the real problem of something, because we want the real problem is often attached to some very often sad and very difficult emotions to feel and experience. And so what we do is we use techniques that we were taught to use, usually from our childhood, to avoid finding the real problem and dealing with that real emotion. And so we become very manipulative and sneaky with the way in which we address issues. And a person who really loves does not do that.
No.
They have a heartfelt desire to completely avoid judgment of oneself and judgment of the other, punishment of self and punishment of the other, because love doesn't do such things.
Yeah.
So we avoid those things completely.
Yeah.
What we do instead is we do focus on finding the real cause, the real heart of the issue, what really happened here.
Yes.
From God's perspective, not from our own.
And this is where our desire for God's truth really comes into play a lot, doesn't it?
But it's also our desire to understand God's love and our desire to understand love that drives this. We recognize that judgment and self-judgment and punishment and self-punishment are unloving behaviors, addictions that we need to remove from ourselves if we're truly going to be loving.
Okay, final thing. Love in the relationship looks like both of us always taking loving action to resolve any issues of arrogance, unloving or untruthful behavior within the relationship.
So here again, we've raised the issue of arrogance with humility and we've raised the issue of arrogance with truth, but now we're raising the issue of arrogance with love. It's not loving to be arrogant, quite simply. Arrogance is a state which basically says that I am superior to you.
I have more worth than you.
Therefore, I'm saying that I have more worth than you. Therefore, I'm saying that I'm worth more, my value is more than you. And that is not a state of love. Now, when one or both parties, one or the other party, in a relationship believe themselves to be superior, then they are not being loving. And the only results that can come from that are bad. That it's going to be the only way that the other party can be living with them is that they believe themselves to be inferior and have less worth. So it's not only damaging to the person who has the arrogance, but it's very, very damaging to the person who believes themselves to be less worth, have less worth or to be valueless.
Yeah.
And such relationships, usually one person has the power in the relationship and the other person meekly goes along with that power generally, although many times in a facade doing so. You know, they might get with their friends and think differently, but stay with the person for other reasons. This is a serious problem in a relationship. Having arrogance and having a sense of superiority is a very serious problem in a relationship. And unless you address it, it will definitely result in the dissolution of the relationship.
All right. We mentioned so many things about love and what that looks like in a relationship. Rather than
revise them all,
I think that we've now created a good introduction to the next part of this session where we want to talk, apply some of the things we've just spoken about to specific issues in a relationship and the specific injuries and how they affect a relationship.
Well, it might turn out to be the next part of the next session.
The next session. It might be session four.
Because my feelings are I want to probably leave it there for this session. I feel we've given people enough information here. We're going to, what we're going to do in the next session is we'll sort of flesh out that information. We'll expand upon it, looking at particular aspects of it, if you like, in regard to things like facade, arrogance, and you know,
and how our will,
how our will is involved in the relationship, and perhaps what we'll do in this session actually is raise the issue now of will. I think we need to go to that next question, and we'll have that in this session. And then we'll leave the other discussions to the next session, because I feel once the person understands the basics of humility, the basics of truth and the basics of love, and then engages their will, which we'll talk about now, I think you've got the real, a real solid foundation now to develop a very, very loving and beautiful relationship with the person you're with.
Yes, I feel that though that many couples resist these concepts and so then they feel like they're lost when it comes to listening to this material.
Yes.
And that's because just of some personal resistance within themselves that they need to face. So that's our encouragement to you to face some of that resistance.
So we've covered the issue of humility, truth and love. Now let's cover the issue of will and then we'll leave this session there.
For now. How's our relationship affected by our use of will?
Yes, well, I feel this is the key ingredient, if you like, of the relationship. Because while we're not yet perfected in humility,
mm-hmm.
and we're not yet perfected in truth, and we're not yet perfected in love, there must be something that drives us to want to be perfected in these particular things.
Yeah.
And in particular, want to be perfected in those things inside of our relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the only thing that really drives us, it's not like God's there with a chain saying, you must, you know, and whipping us with a chain or whip or whatever. We're not going to have somebody on our back telling us that we should do it. We're not going to have someone, you know, geeing us up and motivating us to do it. So what is it going to be driven by? Well, it's going to be driven by how we use collectively in the relationship our will.
Yeah.
How you use your will, how I use mine. If I don't understand the use of my will in the relationship, then I will not probably do the things necessary to grow the relationship to a place of perfection.
Yeah. In fact, I won't.
There's highly likely I won't.
Yeah.
Without my will being engaged, it's impossible in reality to reach a condition of perfection in your relationship. It's going to have to be driven by some pretty strong desires and passions for you to work through the particular issues in order to reach that condition. And it's going to have to be, you're going to have to not just sort of be satisfied with codependent addiction out of harmony with love in that place.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, we're going to only be satisfied with us bringing our relationship into harmony with God's viewpoints rather than our own.
Yeah.
And this is where the majority of relationships, I feel, fall down on one or both parties, where the will is not engaged to improve the relationship to the point of perfection. And the will is often engaged very negatively, with regard to the aspect of humility, negatively regard to the aspect of truth, and negatively even regard to the aspect of love. It's often bartering systems, it's often untruthful behavior, and it's often very arrogant and unloving behavior mm-hmm. that occurs inside of relationships, and people wanting to hold on to those particular will-based motivations. That drives the relationship, and therefore most relationships have struggle, pretty much all relationships struggle, and half of them in the world break up because of these particular issues.
So if we're in that situation where we look at our relationship, we go, hey, there's codependence, there's no personal humility, or there's no collective humility, our track record on truth is pretty poor. I can see there's no evidence of love, or there's very little evidence of love in our relationship. I have to come to terms with the fact that currently my will is being used to avoid humility, to avoid truth, and to avoid perfecting my love for my partner.
And so then, can I say that I really want a loving relationship?
Well, I can't.
And I have to come face to face with that fact that unless I'm developing those aspects of humility, truth, and love, I personally don't really want a loving relationship. I want a relationship based on BART or addiction or whatever else I'm getting out of this relationship. Might be just the sex. And I only want a relationship based on that and not based upon the things that bind relationships together, you know, in the long term, or, you know, if it's a soulmate relationship, even forever.
Mm-hmm.
So I need to question my motivation, my desires, my passions, my intentions. I need to question whether I really do want to have a proper relationship and whether I really do want, in fact, for my relationship to grow. Or am I just very content with it remaining as it is, or remaining in a relationship with somebody I don't care for, don't love, and are not willing to grow with?
Mm-hmm.
Is this relationship really just a stopgap between me having sex and not having sex, and therefore a stopgap relationship in order to hold me over for another relationship that I hope will come along in the future?
Mm.
I've got to be honest with myself about these particular things. If my will is being exercised in that way, then this relationship is not going to work anyway. You know, and if my will is being exercised to avoid personal change and to avoid personal confrontation of my personal emotional condition and to avoid my personal you know, soul condition, if you like, which is a sum total of all of our experiences, truth, love, humility, and all these other things, and I'm here to avoid all of this, then I'm way out of harmony with love from God's perspective, and I'm using my will very negatively, and the only consequence can be a pain and suffering from this relationship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think we need to start this little section on will with that introduction.
Yeah.
How we both individually use our will is very dependent on, everything very much depends upon that.
Yeah.
I can use my will to develop the relationship while you use your will to not do it. And we're in a hopeless situation. Mm-hmm. For there to be any hope in the relationship, for a relationship to occur, both of us need to learn to use our will to the same intense amount.
Yeah.
And this is something that I see missing in most relationships. One or the other do not use their will to build their relationship. One or the other has less passion to develop their will in the relationship, less desire to develop their will in the relationship. One or the other doesn't want to address their lower passion or desire to address their relationship,
yeah,
or themselves, or their own nature and, you know, faults and so forth. And as a result, the relationship will eventually fall apart.
Yeah.
There's no hope of that kind of a relationship continuing in the long term.
And there's really no point even considering the concepts that we're discussing if the will is not,
Yeah, I would say it is definitely a point to me considering the concepts,
yep,
and me working through my own personal issues, whether I'm in a relationship or not. In fact, I would recommend that any person who's even considering a relationship work through these four points of humility, truth, and love for themselves before they even enter a relationship. That's what I would suggest to them. So there is definite worth to that, but I understand what you're getting at, and that is this point that really the relationship itself, mm-hmm, is useless to try and establish if one party has that strong desire to do that and the other party has no desire whatsoever to do it.
Yeah.
And we need to be honest about it.
We do.
And the party that has a desire to do it should not impose their desires upon their other party. They should not manipulate, emotionally force them, or do anything else with them to get them to change their mind. But you can see that they should probably also not be with them because they're going to get hurt if they are.
And as you mentioned, if the person is engaging with the first three principles of humility, truth, and love, and working through those issues, then they will naturally come to that conclusion that you just mentioned, which is, unless both of our wills are engaged, I'm ignoring love of myself here, and I must withdraw.
Yes. And you might remain loving that person for the rest of your life and never enter a relationship with another person. In other words, you might know that that person is your soulmate even, and never enter a relationship with another person all your life, and your love only be for that person, but you still would step back from the relationship until that person has a pure desire to love.
Yeah.
And you know, this is something that is very difficult to do. I see very few people do it on earth. Lots and lots and lots of our brothers and sisters in the spirit world, particularly in the celestial heavens, do this all the time, mm-hmm, where they are continually working with their other halves, their soulmates, working through issues to try and help their other halves get to the point where they actually have their own desire, mm-hmm, to work through these issues.
Yeah.
And once that happens, it's usually an overjoyed response, you know.
Yeah.
But until that occurs, then you're going to be alone the rest of your life.
Mm.
And actually that's fine, you'll find, because once you enter a relationship with God where you're completely blissful, it's okay with you to be alone because you never feel alone. So, you know, you're not driven by addiction to be in relationship. You're driven by the desire to give the gift of your love to the other half.
Okay, so we've established that this ingredient of will is essential if we're going to work through the issues of humility, truth, and love in the relationship.
And the will must exist in both parties for a relationship to continue.
Yeah. Now, this is usually when people panic because they realise, I don't have will, I can't manufacture.
Well, you know what I find?
Yep.
Is most people panic because they feel that the other person doesn't have will.
Mm.
When the reality is their soul-based will, this person's soul-based mm-hmm. will, is actually already out of harmony with love, with addiction and demand and other things anyway.
Yeah.
So they're often not honest
yes.
about their panic.
There's a lot of projection onto the other party of blame.
Correct.
And for all of the issues.
Yes.
And not recognizing their own flaws in the way they're using their will out of harmony with humility, truth and love.
Yes. For most relationships that have degraded over time, initially there was some attraction.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point of attraction, one or both parties entered their addictions. And when the addictions are imposed upon another party, and this particularly occurs when there's a party who believes themselves to be superior to other, mm-hmm. and I notice many women in relationship believe themselves to be superior to men in the relationship,
yep.
they then have a lot of projected demands upon the, in this case, the male in the relationship.
Mm-hmm.
That male eventually detunes from the relationship. He doesn't leave it for other reasons, but he will detune from the relationship. He will eventually have a very low will to address the issues in the relationship because from his perspective, he believes that she only wants everything her way,
mm-hmm.
right?
Which
is probably true.
That is how she's using her will, by maintaining addictions, isn't
correct.
It?
Correct. And she does only want things her way,
mm-hmm.
right? Now, under these circumstances, you cannot expect that man to develop a will thinking that the woman's only desire is to have him do everything she wants. That is not a relationship that's based on will on both parties. So many of these women then believe they have a will to improve their relationship, but the reality is they only have a will to change the man.
And have more of their addictions.
And have
man.
More of their addictions, man.
Which is not the kind of will that is required to work through, to actually have a loving relationship.
Correct. And the men oftentimes are only motivated by the will to have sex.
Yeah.
And so he wants his wife to only change with the way she has sex and nothing else,
mm-hmm.
right? And this is him imposing upon her, again, what I would classify as a codependent addiction rather than a true soul-based loving will in order to grow the relationship.
So let's go back to the beginning of your scenario there where you say people enter a relationship. And often you mentioned earlier there's chemistry and there's all these feelings
mm-hmm.
that people often call a desire to love the other person.
Yes.
So we can't confuse that with actually having a true will to work through issues in a relationship to the point where the relationship is loving.
Correct.
And many people do mislabel that first initial a spark of attraction
yes.
as a will to work through issues that then leaves them.
Yes.
The truth is that the majority of people on the planet have not developed this will
yes.
to work through the issues of humility, truth and love in a partner relationship.
Particularly because it's painful emotionally to themselves.
Yes.
And so they don't do it. That's the main problem, right?
That's the main problem.
Yeah.
So now that we've said that, no one really has this will, even if they've entered a relationship where they think that...
When I say no one, I think, you know, there are obviously people who have the will, but I feel quite strongly that there are many times where people come to us and they say, look, you know, my husband doesn't want to work through his issues. And this is a common complaint from many women who speak to us.
Yeah.
And what I feel from them is that those particular women generally want their husband to do everything they want. And if I was her husband, I would not work through any of those issues either.
Because you'd basically be working through issues of becoming a slave.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I'm certainly not going to do that.
Yeah.
Right. And he knows that the only result of him working through the particular issues the way she wants is that he will become her slave.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't want to be her slave. So he stays unwillingly in the relationship and in a state of what I would classify as emotional detunement. He tries to detune from her emotionally. So he goes fishing and he goes and does other things with his mates and does as many things as possible to get away from her, right? While maintaining a relationship because of the kids and the financial issues and other pressing matters.
Mm-hmm.
This is not a use of both parties' will, right?
Yeah.
They are willingly, both of them, avoiding the real issues. She is avoiding the fact that she's overbearing and demanding, and it has a whole heap of expectations which are unloving. And he is overlooking the fact that he's unwilling to be honest about it, and unwilling to be truthful about it, and actually he's just a pushover. Mm-hmm. And he needs to address that problem because he doesn't love himself. And he needs to address those issues. Now, when he or she addresses those issues, their relationship will look a lot different.
Yeah.
And in fact, it may go through a lot of upheaval and a lot of emotional trauma mm-hmm. to look different.
Yeah.
But they would be far better off using their will to love God's way than they're currently using their will.
Mm.
We also see many women in particular call us about their relationships. And they say, you know, he does this, he does that, he does this, he does that, he does this, so I should leave him, shouldn't I? And I'm saying, what do you do? I'm trying and I'm this and I'm like, so she's doing everything good and he's doing everything bad. The reality is I don't believe you. Don't try to convince me that that's true, because you're just trying to feed me a heap of crap now, basically. Like, it's just a heap of crap that's in the middle of the room now that you're putting there. The reality is, for the majority of people, they're in codependent addiction. She has addictions, he has addictions. She has imposed her addictions on him, he has imposed his addictions on her. She and he need to develop a will to change that. She thinks she has a will to change it, but she doesn't. She only has a will to change him,
mm-hmm.
which is very, very different than having a will to change her own behavior,
mm-hmm.
right? He wants her to change before he'll do anything, which is actually very, very different than him deciding to do something without her, right? And these are problems that people face with their will.
Yeah. So if a couple gets honest enough
yeah.
to acknowledge, what you're just highlighting there is that most people, or a lot of people, aren't even honest enough about the true state of their will with regards to the relationship.
No.
So that seems like...
Honestly, most people have no faith now. They believe a good relationship's not possible. Now it's just a matter of maintaining a relationship of a kind for whatever purposes, whether it be to bring up children or to have some financial security or to have some sex sometimes or whatever the reason is. They're just maintaining a relationship that's not perfect, that's not really happy. It might be contentment, you know, to a degree. It's not blissful.
Mm-hmm.
And they both basically stay in it, fooling themselves that you know, that's all that they can get.
Yeah. So from what you're saying, if we want to actually shift from a place where there's no will-based desire in either of us to actually be more humble, to honor truth and to become loving, we have to get real about the true state of our will.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, we have to work through some of those disillusioned emotions, actually grieve through some of those emotions about feeling hopeless about there ever being the chance of a perfect or loving relationship.
I sort of believe, though, that if a person works through the emotion personally, that they will never be perfect. Then also the disillusionment about having a perfected relationship will largely dissipate.
Yes.
And then if they work through the emotion that their partner will never want to be perfect,
mm-hmm.
they'll work through the rest of them.
Yeah.
They'll work through the rest of the emotions necessary to get rid of the disillusionment about there being a perfect relationship.
So if we get real about the state of our will,
mm-hmm.
we're willing to grieve our feelings that we can never be personally perfect, especially in love.
Yeah, or that our partner doesn't want to be perfect.
And grieve our feelings that we believe our partner doesn't want to be perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're taking some concrete steps towards growing this will.
Yes.
In the right direction of having a loving partnership.
Anybody who's listened to the assistance groups in 2014 that we did on the talks about will would know there's a big difference between will and willpower, and that will to change requires emotions to be felt. So what we're suggesting here is that you'll have to feel some emotions to change your will.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't feel those emotions, you will not change your will.
Yeah.
Your motivations will be the same as always.
Yeah.
You're going to have to work your way through some things here
yeah.
to change your will into a passionate desire to actually grow in love with your partner.
Yeah.
And it requires a lot of effort to work through those particular emotions.
So it's not just a single decision where I go, oh, that's it, I've changed my mind, we're turning this boat around and we're going for
it. Well, it could be if you had no emotional impediments to that condition. But yeah. If you have emotional impediments to that condition, no, because this human soul operates at a state of preclusion. If I've got an emotion inside of me that doesn't allow me to develop a will in a certain direction, then while that emotion exists, my will won't develop in that direction. I need to release the emotion first before I will change my will.
Yeah.
Right. So yes, it requires a shift emotionally inside of myself to shift. Now, for the male, in the examples that I've given, he might have to shift to realize that he needs to change whether she changes or not.
Yeah.
Right. And for the wife, she needs to see that actually her impositions upon him are unloving right from the beginning, and she needs to change that. And if she changes those particular things, he might decide to change. He might actually like us a bit more than he currently does. Right. So we start realizing that if we act in harmony with love and we exercise our will independent of the other, then there's a higher likelihood of the other also independently using their will to grow as well.
So it's a very good point that you made, isn't it? In the example with the woman who's coming to us complaining about her husband, basically wanting him to change his will, and not examining her own will-based oppression, really.
Of him. Yes.
She's doing the opposite of what needs to happen, both
correct.
With regards to her will.
Yes.
And in fact, if she had as few issues as she claims to have, she wouldn't be there complaining.
Well, the reality is if she had as few issues as she claims she has, he would probably already be doing something.
Yes. And that's a crucial point that you just made there.
Yes.
That the... Once we take personal responsibility for our will within the partnership, this does have an impact upon our partner.
It draws the other person into doing the same. If you think about when we first met, my will being fully engaged in developing humility, developing truth, developing love, and using my will to do those particular things with a high concentration of my effort and time, that caused you to aspire to the same condition.
Certainly.
And my suggestion is if your partner is not aspiring to the same condition, it's highly likely you aren't doing it, even though you claim you are.
Yep.
Highly likely. The law of attraction works perfectly. And it's very, very hard to keep yourself in a negative place while your partner is growing to be in a positive place.
Yep.
You will recognize the changes in your partner and you'll begin to have the same aspirations as your partner has as a result.
Yep.
Right? Now, if your partner does not have the same aspirations as yourself, then it's highly likely that you don't have the aspirations you claim to have.
Yeah.
And you're just fooling yourself and delusional.
Yeah.
Yes. And we need to recognize that.
Good points.
Yeah. So when it comes to using our will, if we go back over the first three questions that we raised, we need to use our will in those three areas as well.
Yes. So a soul-based will to be humble with myself and my partner allows me to confront all of the areas we talked about in question one of this session.
Correct. So if I don't have a soul-based will to actually confront the issues of humility personally, then it's highly likely that I won't have a soul-based will to confront the issues of humility in the relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Makes sense.
Perfect sense.
Same applies to truth.
So a soul-based will for truth about myself and with my partner allows me to confront all of the areas that we discussed in question two of this session.
Correct. So if I don't have a soul-based will, as we discussed in question two of this session, and we actually don't have a soul-based will for God's truth and for truth itself and for absolute truth, then of course it's highly unlikely that we're going to engage the points we raised in point two, in that part two of this session. So therefore, we'll receive none of the benefits of having truth in our relationship.
Yeah. Okay, final point.
Yes.
A soul-based will to love allows me to confront the areas stated in question 3 of his session.
So the same applies. If I don't have a passionate desire in myself to change myself with regard to love, then it's highly unlikely that I'm going to be able to change my love-based relationship with my partner.
Yeah.
And so we need to be honest about these things. We need to be downright, like, brutal with ourselves about these things, really. And yeah. I don't see it as brutal, but a lot of people do. Like, I am very brutal with myself in the average, you know, way that everybody sees it, with regard to truthful with myself about these matters. Am I really humble enough? Am I really truthful enough? Do I really want to love enough? Is my desire fully engaged or not? And I am really, as you know, quite strong on that with myself.
You're not punishing of yourself.
No, I don't punish myself.
Very, very honest.
Yes, very honest. Very factually honest about this matter. Do I really have my will developed in that regard, or am I avoiding things? What's really going on for me? Now, if I can't change my will in regard to those first 3 things we raised in the questions parts 1, 2, and 3 of this session,
yeah,
then it's highly unlikely that my soulmate, my other half, the person I'm living with, will change her will or his will.
Mm-hmm.
It's highly unlikely, because my will has the power to draw the other person's will into the same condition.
Which is awesome when you think
awesome,
about
yeah.
it. Yeah.
But if I am waiting for them and I'm resentfully going, I'm only going to do it if they do,
mm-hmm.
or I'm saying to myself, I'm not going to do it unless they do it first, right? Which is requiring something of them that you're not requiring of yourself,
yep.
then you are being very unloving and very resistive to using your will in a positive direction, right? So these are, I see people engaging this behavior constantly in their relationships,
yep.
right? Where they are constantly wanting the other person to do something that they themselves are not prepared to do. And I'm saying, I need to be fully prepared to do all these 4 things, this desire for humility, desire for truth, desire for love. It needs to be passionate in my life and demonstrable mm-hmm. as a passion in my life. I need to be changing. The people around me need to see me changing, because if they can't see me changing, I'm not changing.
Yeah.
They need to see me becoming more loving.
Yeah.
That's what they need to observe. And if they can't observe it, then I'm probably not becoming more loving.
Yeah.
Right? And once I engage these particular things, it's highly unlikely that my most closest companion, the person who's living with me, will not observe the changes in me.
And be drawn towards change themselves.
And therefore be drawn towards using their will
yeah.
to change themselves.
Yeah.
Yes. Now, eventually, obviously, if it turns out after years of this that both parties do not have an engaged will, then you may separate for a time until one or the other party does engage their will.
Mm-hmm.
But you wouldn't enter other relationships if you truly loved the person.
Yeah.
And if you believed that person was your soulmate, right? So you may have time periods where you're alone, or even in your relationship, you may have time periods where you spend time, months or even sometimes years, depending on the circumstances, alone
mm-hmm.
while you're working through these particular issues. But the key is to have the developed will yeah. to go through it.
Yeah.
Because it's only the developed will that will pull you through it.
Yeah.
Without it, you won't get through it. You won't. You'll give up. You'll go and get an addiction met somewhere else. You'll go and have an affair. You'll go and do a whole heap of things which will be very out of harmony with love
yeah.
and cause a whole heap of pain and suffering just to avoid certain things.
Yeah, and our entire first assistance group is all about developing and strengthening will to love, isn't it?
Yes.
So there'll be a lot of tools and a lot of assistance for people to look at this issue of will and sincerely
yes.
make changes.
So this is the Education in Love series that we're talking about that yep. we've developed for 2016 through to 2018. And the whole of the first 6 days is all about will. And in fact, a general theme that goes through the entire 48 days of these Good. Discussions we'll yep. be having with people are actually... It always comes back to, how are you using your will? How are you using your will? How are you using your will? Yeah. And in a relationship, we have the power to use our will for good or for bad, just like we have the power to use our will in the same directions in all aspects of our life. Yeah. And we're going to require some deep sincerity if we're going to have a perfect relationship in the end. Mm-hmm. And we're going to both have to engage it, whether we like it or not.
Yeah.
But in the end, if we truly engage our will, we will like it. Yeah. We will like the changes that it brings about. We will enjoy the growth in the relationship, the closer relationship, the building sexual desire and sexual passion that occurs in the relationship, and every other change that builds and changes and grows and passions that grow in the relationship will be a huge source of joy for our relationship if we do it.
Yeah.
And that's what we need to have faith in. Because if we don't have faith in that, we probably won't engage our will at the beginning.
Yeah.
Mm. So what we'd like to do in conclusion is encourage all of you to develop these four qualities, which are the same four qualities, ironically, that you'll need in your relationship with God. Isn't that wonderful? And if you can develop these four qualities in your relationship, then you have a great chance of perfecting your relationships to the point where everything in your life is perfect. You're perfect, your partner's perfect, and your relationship's perfect. And this place of perfection is possible for you, and we'd like to encourage you to believe and have faith in the fact that God created perfect laws, God created you to be perfect, and God created your relationship to be perfect. And as long as you have some strong will and desire to generate this perfected self and perfected relationship, you're going to greatly enjoy your partner relationships. So I'd like to thank Mary for sharing that with me today.
Thank you, darling.
And also the guys who are recording us today for sharing our session today as well. Thanks, guys.